This is the 8th rendition of the Living the City double feature lecture series here every Thursday. Living the City is an exhibition, a publication, a program of events about cities, people, and stories. My name is Lukas Feierreis. I'm one of the co-curators of the exhibition. My name is Lukas Feigreis. I'm one of the co-curators of the exhibition, and on behalf of the entire curatorial team, which is Tatjana Schneider and the Green Isle, I would like to warmly welcome you all and thank you for being here. This is you, the audience. This is you, Michelle and Bonaventure. The setup for tonight remains the same as every Thursday. First, I'll give a brief introduction to the two of you. Then each of the speakers has about 20 minutes to talk, give a presentation, and then we'll engage in a conversation, ask some questions. All together, we're here for about 1 hour. So tonight, we have a Rotterdam-based architectural historian, Michelle Provost, and Berlin-based curator, Bonaventure So Bejeng Didung, with us. As I said, every Thursday, it's a coincidence that you happen to be together today, because the way we organized these Thursdays was really by the calendar. So who has time on what day? But it turned out that they always work really well together. And today it seems that this is the case again. The red thread that I have the feeling will be tonight is the kind of critical discussion of the strategic and the tactical powers that be in urban public space, and an understanding of the complex interactions between power and powerlessness in contemporary society as they get shaped in urban space. But we'll see. So that said, I'm looking forward to your talks. And let's start with you, Michelle. Michelle Provost, we met about 8 years ago at a panel discussion here in Berlin, organized by Regula Lüscher, and I think it was you, Jean-Philippe Vassal of Lacaton Vassal, and myself, and we spoke at the St. Elisabethkirche in Berlin. I believe it was about Berlin master plans. And then again, we crossed paths in another way without meeting in person, was in Shenzhen, at the Shenzhen Biennial for Architecture and Urbanism, in which we both participated as artists. The biennial was, interestingly enough, called Reliving the City. Our exhibition is called Living the City. And there you showed the first, let's say, rendition of the work that we are also featuring in our exhibition. So Michelle, you are an architectural historian. You're specialized in urban planning history and in post-war architecture and generally in contemporary urban development, redevelopment. You are one of the co-founders of Crimson Historians and Urbanists. You founded Crimson's, I believe, in 1994. And you have subsequently been engaged in a large number of very different research as well as design projects in the field of urban planning, architecture, art, but also advising as well as policy making. Since 2008, you're the director of the International New Town Institute in Almere. There's many, many more positions. You have been teaching at various universities in the Netherlands and abroad. So thank you so much for finding the time and being with us. Your talk tonight is entitled, Do You Hear the People Sing? So the screen is yours, Michelle.
Yeah. Thanks for the introduction. And that saves me the trouble of explaining in a lengthy way who I am and who Crimson is. Do you see my screen already?
Yes.
Good. So Crimson, architectural historians, that is actually our previous name. Now we're called historians and urbanists because we got an extra member who's actually not a historian but an urbanist. But it gives our background in a very clear way, since we're mostly historians. Let's see how I get to the next slide. But apart from that, you could say these as historians, we've taken a quite unusual path, I would say, since the beginning, 26 years ago. We've done research and published books on all kinds of urban subjects, like transformation, like infrastructure, like, well, you name it, a lot of things that we thought were relevant. But we also, from the start, were engaged in making urban plans, in designing, and in actual doing transformations, what we call re-arch, like this project in Rotterdam. It was the transformation of a railway viaduct. And always, and this will be the topic of my talk today, we've done exhibitions, mostly as a way of doing research or as presenting research. So of course, it is always, depending on the topic, you have to decide, will this be a book, an exhibition, a pamphlet, a documentary, etc. But I must say that the format of an exhibition has worked quite well with us, and we enjoyed it a lot. So we did a number of exhibitions on the Venice Biennale, but also for other occasions. Just pointing out a few here, and this is one that we did in Italy, and was in the Maxi Center, which was designed by Zaha Hadid, and as a result had no straight walls. So it had all these walls that were twisted and multiple angles. And so we found that we did the, when we did the drawing, the panoramic drawing, we presented then, called The Granary on Food Security. We couldn't just print it on the wall and glue it because of this, all these twists. So we hired this guy who was drawing artisan, also made pictures and drawings in pizzerias in Rome. So he was advised to us as being a really good guy. But in the lower image, you see the eventual artwork that was presented at the exhibition. And as you can see on the right hand side, he never completely finished it. So that was one of our first panoramic drawings, maybe a little bit too big to finish. But the one that we're presenting at Living the City, at your exhibition, Lucas, is actually a lot bigger. It was, I think, 22 meters long, a panorama called Do You Hear the People Sing? And we presented it at the Shenzhen Hong Kong Biennale of Architecture and Urbanism, the one you just mentioned. I think it was in 2015. And we were in an exhibition that was themed Radical Urbanism, and was curated by the guys from the Urban Think Tank, Alfredo Brillenburg and Hubert Klumpner. And this Radical Urbanism obviously referred to their way of working in urban planning, with bottom-up initiatives, with communities that they empowered to build and design their own environment. And this was the kind of collection that they wanted to show in this Radical Urbanism exhibition, in this pavilion, so to speak. So we thought, what can we do within this theme? And then we came up with the topic of protests in public space, for a number of reasons. In the first place, you could say that the street and public space and its are in essence a democratic and open element of the city. It's meant for the whole public, with for everybody. That's the meaning of public space. But if you see it as the pinnacle of democracy, then of course, you could also say, how is that used by the public? And you could say that maybe if you talk about radical use of public space, then protests and riots form a kind of a radical urbanism, because there is always a relation with the urban environment. If you look at riots in the 20th century, And this was at that moment exactly the topic that my colleague Wouter van Siphout from Crimson was writing a publication on riots in cities. So that fit together well. But the second reason was that it was in China. And at that moment, there were not only the public protests as part of the Arab Spring in Cairo, Tunis, etc., or the Gezi Park in Turkey, or the banlieues had recently been in the riots in France. But there was also the umbrella protest in Hong Kong. And of course, you know that Shenzhen is at a few kilometers distance of Hong Kong. So we thought this was absolutely a relevant topic for Shenzhen. And also we noticed in other projects that we did in China that the quality of public space was at that moment really a hot topic in Shenzhen and other places in China. Raising the quality, beautifying it in all kinds of way, also putting an emphasis on cultural facilities that connect to public space. But we thought for a biennale, it's also useful to show the complete width of the meaning of public space, that it's also and only a public space when it's also a space for protest. And well, of course, we knew this was controversial in China, but we still thought it was relevant. We talked to the curators if we could include this umbrella protest. And well, there seemed to be no problem. So we went ahead. And well, here you see the panorama. Do you hear the people sing, how it was exhibited in the Shenzhen Biennale? I'll zoom in on three different parts of the panorama. And it's basically, it's one allegorical street of 22 meters long with different protests and riots in different parts of the world at moments in time. And here you see the inner city riots in American cities in the 1960s. Which had a very close relation to urban renewal in the American cities at that time, which you see depicted at the very left hand of this drawing. The inner cities were basically dilapidated, old, sometimes in ruins. And the urban renewal that the American planners saw fit was basically to demolish it and replace it by huge new developments. You have to remember this was also the time of Robert Moses with all his introductions of large infrastructural projects and the protests of, for instance, Jane Jacobs against that. So in all American cities, this was a kind of practice that was hugely contested, but especially in Detroit, there was a very, well, famous, well-known riot in 1967 that had to do not only with this demolishing of old homes, but especially the fact that these old homes were housing the communities of Afro-American people at that time. And this was also still part of America was still a segregated country at the time. You could, of course, argue that it still is, but at that moment it was for sure. Schools were segregated, and this segregation even became stronger because of white middle-class families fleeing the inner cities, which you see in the right-hand part, this van with the white family moving to the suburbs. So everyone that could afford to move from the inner city went to the suburbs, leaving this inner cities for the poor black communities. What you also see here, so it is a combination between these protests, the streets that they happened in, and the urban planning background that made them actually come into existence. And of course, in every scene, there's a lot of details. Like, for instance, you see here a little bit in the middle. I'm not sure if I can point this out, but here you see the what are they called again? The Marbellas.
Banners.
Yeah. Who had this, whose song became kind of a theme. I'm sure that Bonaventure will maybe have it later on, because his work that he shared with us just a minute ago, this music is actually a little bit like the soundtrack of this work. So I hope we can get back to that. But also this guy who's showing a sign, I am a man, of course, deals with this huge inequality between black and white at that moment. And also here you see James Baldwin, who literally said, like, urban renewal is Negro removal. Pardon the word, but this is literally his saying. And that was how it was felt. And I'm sure that is also what it was actually at that moment. So a very close relation between our profession and these riots and the place that they happened in. This is a detail. The second scene that I'm taking out is much more recent. This is 2005, the riots that happened in the banlieues in France, that started with police brutality in killing two boys, basically 15 and 17, that were fleeing for the police, looked for refuge in a power station and got themselves electrocuted. And this sparked riots first in the outskirts of Paris, but then moving all over Paris to exactly these same environments, these banlieues. And one of the typical things of these riots were that they were all taking place in these banlieues with all the same architecture, which you see here in the background. So flats, apartments, modernist, industrialized buildings. That's where the poor, mostly with a migrant background, people lived, far away from the center where the where work is. Again, a very unequal situation, and lots of unemployment and social inequality that sparked all this social unrest. Interestingly enough, there were other conclusions that were drawn from this situation. Not so much that these areas were in need of help, improvement, regeneration, investment, you name it, but completely different. In the professional community, the conclusion was, this is a proof that the ideas of Le Corbusier, which are behind these kind of banlieues, don't work, that they have failed, and we should never work with these modernist principles again. So this is why you see the modular being toppled over right in the middle of this scene. But also right-wing politicians took advantage of these riots. On the right hand, you see both Sarkozy and Jean-Marie Le Pen, who were, Sarkozy said, this is, you can see that these migrants are scum. We should really use force to counter these riots. And Jean-Marie Le Pen basically said the same. So there was also a misuse of these riots in a very strong way. And then this image shows the protest that the work actually takes its name from, Do You Hear the People Sing, which is, as you may know, a song from the a French, I forgot the name. It was used in the beginning of the 19th century by rebel students to counter the government. And this song, which became very popular, from Les Misérables, that is the name. And it was taken by the Hong Kong students to be their anthem for the protests. And looking back on this, actually, I think it's very, very sad to see now. It was at the time, it was one of the most best organized protests. They had these tent camps where they even had sanitation and libraries and tents to sleep in, and was all highly organized and regulated. They had these umbrellas with words on it where were lots of poetic slogans. But here you could also see that when they camped out in front of a government building, they were actually sent away from this supposedly public space, public square. So also there you could see this public space is not really so public. It's public as long as you behave. And especially with the most recent developments with China getting this firmer grip on Hong Kong and the protest figureheads being sent to jail, this is actually a very sad to look back on. At that moment, it looked still like it could be successful, but well, as we know now, it's, well, you could say it really hasn't been. And to conclude this this exhibition, we knew it was controversial, as I mentioned. None of the curators seemed to be worried, but at the very end, right before the opening, we received message from the censorship that we had to cover up the last part dealing with the umbrella revolution. So we took this white cloth and hung it over the very last part of the work. And of course, this only triggered more excitement and curiosity. Everybody wanted to know what was behind it. So thank you, censorship, for this attention. But I thought the most interesting aspect of this, and also touching, was that the Shenzhen Biennale was visited mostly by Chinese people, of course, being in China, and Chinese students, moreover. And they were really shocked by what was portrayed behind this cloth, because they didn't know about the whole existence of the umbrella movement. It was successfully kept out of Chinese media. So it was completely new for them, and they were moved to tears when they actually saw what was going on at just a few kilometers distance from there. So and also talking here, you see my colleague from Crimson, who is half Chinese, and her family lives in Hong Kong. And you could see how these discussions between the younger generation and the older generation were actually really tearing the population apart, and also families. So that was, very strong, that made a very strong impact on us. Then I would like to show another exhibition, but only if I have time. How about
running? We have our 20 minutes, so if you wrap it up quickly in 2-3 minutes, I give that to you.
Okay, I'll just go through it very quickly, because this is just to show you how the relation between research and exhibition actually is in our work. So we never make an exhibition just like that. It's always the outcome of research. And one of the other topics, apart from these protests in public space, was that of migration, which we started, like many projects on migration, in 2015. And then we called it City of Comings and Goings. And we decided to focus that research on two aspects: to zoom out, not only to zoom in on the refugees that were coming into Europe at that moment, but to zoom out and to show that there actually is a huge history of migration, that it has been with us since the beginning since the beginning of cities, and that Europe and European cities have always been shaped by migration. And that migrants are not only refugees, but that they can also be other kinds of migrants, like international students or expats or tourists, and not all of them are being seen as problematic. But they do pose extra questions to our cities. So if we are unable to house all refugees and house migrants, we should probably look at our cities closer and adjust them so that they can, and use different typologies for housing, amenities, commercial spaces, public services, to accommodate this influx of migrants and also outflux. So this increasingly dynamic condition of our cities. We looked at how are we doing so far and made a catalogue of 100 projects in Western Europe so that we could compare the different cities, both in physical projects, but also more social projects. And then we showed the results of this research in a few years ago at the Biennale of Venezia again. And the masterpiece was this drawing, just like the last drawing in Shenzhen. It was made by an architect called Hugo Corbett. So he's our in-house artist. And what this drawing is basically is an allegory of a migrant city. It consists solely of buildings and public space that you can connect to the fleeting nature of our cities and to this dynamics of migrants coming in and going out. So what you see here in the middle is the gates to Chinatown. There is a Polski sklep here, the Polish supermarket. There is a computer store here where the digital nomads can work. And there is this public space with a Moroccan fountain that gives the symbolic presence of the Moroccan community in this case, in Rotterdam. So this is not an existing city. It's an allegoric migrant city. And we also made the floor plan connected to that. This was printed as a carpet on the floor of this space. And we also made 6 advices on how to accommodate how to improve the quality of our cities to invite migrants. The number one being provide large amounts of cheap space for working and living. So, and now this exhibition, if you still want to see it, it's not in Venice anymore. We took it back to Rotterdam, and now it's part of our own space. We started the Independent School for the City in Rotterdam, and that's where we have it as a decor still. So feel free, you're welcome to visit us if you're in Rotterdam in next year, hopefully. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Michelle. And thank you also so much for really sharing how you guys work, like this very unique hybrid practice that you develop at Crimson, where really the city, the contemporary city, is the object of investigation. And also where they all, it seems like, ways of understanding the global sociopolitical realities that we are faced with on an everyday basis, but against the backdrop of like urban planning or architectural history. No, this is the specification really of your work. And in a way, the 2 projects that you shared with us, The City of Coming and Goings and That You Hear the People Sing, are both analytical, yet the one is kind of looking at past and all the way to contemporary movements in a very analytical way. And I like that you use the term of allegorical for both cases, because it is in a way a collage that you're working with that can hints at certain moments in history. And then the other one, the City of Coming and Goings, yes, there's an artwork at the end, but it's really also proposals. You were making proposals for the city. So it seems like this is always research that looks at the past, it always proposes something for the future.
That is true. I think that's also what we're trying to do as an office, to use our backgrounds as historians to actually help out, come up with ideas based on analysis and knowledge for present societal problems. And of course, there's only so much that you can do being a designer or historian or a scientist, whatever, but in the way that we try to connect our discipline with these relevant topics, like migration, for instance. I think that is the way that we, that we want to work, and that we, try to be influential by giving advices and really making it concrete for our own cities.
In this way, research becomes something that makes certain patterns in society visible for yes. everyone. If we look again at the Do You Hear the People Sing, I think that's a really nice like crossover also to Bonaventure eventually. And you spoke of the title Radical Urbanism, no? That's what Hubert mm-hmm. gave, like the subsection of the Biennale. And here the common denominator is that these diverse protests all over the world that are the essence of this radical urbanism, that all use also the street as the new platform for protest.
Mm-hmm.
And then again, you mentioned, I think, Tahrir Square and Taksim and the umbrella. This is another phenomena. This is another interesting link to you, Bonaventure, in just a second, of how, let's say, the 2 decades into the 21st century, we are witnessing somewhat of a local and a global resurgence of like public collective space as a platform for social and political mobilization. Mm-hmm. It started with the Arab Spring, you could say, and kind of moved through all the way to Occupy Wall Street. And one of the first kind of theoreticians that kind of addressed this phenomena, I think, was Saskia Sassen. She wrote this essay called The Global Street, Making the Political, where she analyzed, this is beyond like an old like Western European idea of public space or such, but it's really the street can be conceived as a space where also new forms of the social and the political can be made, rather than just a space for an acting like ritualized routines. Now, this is a bit of a long one, we are also witnessing, and this is like a little crossover to you, Bonna, because I've read the article that you wrote for Freeze, where you looked at the street protests that are happening at the moment. So while at the one hand, with you, Michelle, we and Do You Hear the People Sing, we looked at street protests that were fighting for social equality or maybe against police brutality or against all kinds of injustices, where the street becomes a place, you know, where democracy is shaped. At the same time, now these street protests that we're witnessing, for example, in Germany as part of these kind of anti-COVID-19 demonstrations, are actually the very democratic structures being attacked in these demonstrations. So there is this contradiction also at the very moment. So maybe that's both of you can like briefly relate to this observation and how far you agree to this or not, or what you thoughts on this now?
Well, I think the recent, especially the Black Lives Matter protests, have shown that the vitality actually of public space and the possibility of these protests to actually shape the democratic thinking and to they have been quite powerful, of course, internationally and globally. I would say that this actually calls for, we should actually update our work of Do the People Sing, because they have, this is sort of what it amounts to, I think. And I also have the hunch that I feel more positive about the influence of and a democratic nature and the change, the radical perspectives of the most recent protests than some of the older ones that we have shown, because you can see that some of them have actually shot themselves in the foot, you could say. And this is, it's also a very painful thing to see.
Bonna, you want to already jump in before I properly introduce you?
No, I think you should just introduce me and then I go ahead, you know, so that we can you know, fit everything within the time frame.
Yes.
Then I'll answer.
So, you'll pick that up in your replies later. So from you, Michelle, thank you so much. And now to you, Bonaventure. So with Zheng Nidikung, we figured it out about 5-6 years ago, introduced via Elena Agudio at the Savvy Contemporary, the space that you've been running for many years. At the time, it was still in Neukölln, and you invited me to join the panel discussion. We also, shortly after, worked on some first ideas on a project on rhythm analysis by Henri Lefebvre, which eventually became another project, and kind of have been crossing paths ever since on many occasions. So thank you so much for being with us. You are an art curator and an art critic and a writer, one of Berlin's finest, but your background is very different. You studied food biotechnology here at the Technical University in Berlin. You did a doctorate in medical biotechnology in Düsseldorf and the TU Berlin, and a postdoctorate in biophysics in Montpellier. But you are known for being the founder and the artistic director of Savvy Contemporary, the laboratory of form ideas. So this is for, let's say, conceptual and intellectual and artistic production exchange. You have been engaged in many, many different forms. You were the curator at large for the Documenta 14 in 2015. You were the guest curator of the Dakar Biennial and the curator of the Finnish Pavilion at the Venice Biennale. I think that was in 2017, correct me if I'm wrong. You served as the artistic director of the 12th Bamako Biennial, basically for African photography in Mali in 19. For the Sonspec 2020-2024, you serve also as, I think, the artistic director. And now, very recently, you took over the professorship for spatial strategies. It's a master program at the Kunsthochschule Weissen, the art school here in Berlin. And last month, not the months before, you received the Order of Merit of the City of Berlin. So congratulations to that. I'm very grateful for having you here with us. The title of your talk today is The Sound of the Police. So the screen is yours.
So Lucas, thank you very much for the introduction. Thanks for the invitation. And Michelle, thanks for your brilliant presentation. And I was quite amazed at how much interconnections were actually there. So that's beautiful. So well curated, Lucas. Before I start, I would like to point out that this, whatever I'm doing here is in memoriam of Marion von Osten, who left us on the 14th of November at the age of 57. Only. And Marion von Osten, as you know, was a very important curator and artist and dealt with a lot of the things we're talking about today, be it in terms of public space or architecture, and her projects like Project Migration, or In the Desert of Modernity, Colonial Planning and After, or Bauhaus Imaginista, quite fundamental, you know, and she was a great supporter of some of the projects we do. So this is in memoriam and in praise of her practice. I'll try to rush over this. It's actually an excerpt from a longer text I'm working on with the title, The Implicate Violence in the Nascent and Performance of Nationhood. And the subtitle is The Sound of the Police. So I'll try to pull out a couple of things from there and read to you. So I won't talk about my projects in general. I won't show any images. I'm really, of the, school of thought of someone like Nilima Sheikh, who in a film about her practice, in Kashmir said, there's certain images we cannot show, because just like the sun, if you look at them, it might blind you. So I'll try to just let the sonic do this. So act one, for some people, living in the city, and especially being seen or heard in the city, is tantamount to being on death row. The city is a coded space, a space in which people, citizens, city dwellers have to carve out their own spaces, where each space is contested physically and psychologically. The city is a political space in which one space to breathe is constantly contested by others who need or want much more air. But if the contention of in city spaces were limited between and within city dwellers, that would be a secondary issue. But the primary concern seems to be that in the city, some humans are more equal than others, some more vulnerable to violences than others. And most often than not, that violence emanates from those who actually have the responsibility to care for us. What is evident is that the racialized, the gendered, the historically disenfranchised, the other, the pariah, the migrant, and so-called refugee, the impoverished in seats in societies are those who bear the brunt of the exercises of mispower in the city and the state. The German notion of Staatsgewalt seems to me an appropriate place to begin a reflection on the exercise of mispower. Staatsgewalt, which literally translates as state violence, but actually means state authority, which in constitutional theory also signifies state power, describes the exercise of sovereign power within the national territory of a state through its organs and institutions, such as the government apparatuses like the administration, the police and army, the parliament, courts, etc. It is often said that in sovereign states, the state has monopoly over Staatsgewalt, over state power. If one were to take the singular entities of Staatsgewalt together, it could easily be tantamount to a multiplication or an amplification of violences, which is to say the city space is the playground on which the violence of the Staatsgewalt is too often manifested on some particular bodies. In the book, Police Forces, A Cultural History of an Institution, Klaus Mladek writes that, and I quote, "Super police force in the war against terrorism, the recent concept of community policing, or the rapid growth of both border police and various private police forces, the police has recently resurfaced as the crucial referent for societal fantasies of law and order. Equipped with the most recent technologies and linked to all available means of data collection, the modern police, as it cooperates with other disciplines of crime, repression, such as criminology, psychiatry, and penal law, works in the name of law and order as the quintessential agent of social control. The fear of crime alongside recent instances of excessive violence committed by the police has created an ambivalent mixture of repulsion for and appreciation of the police within modern democracies," end of quote. Act two, third degree, a poem by Langston Hughes. "Hit me, jab me, make me say I did it. Blood on my sport shirt, on my tan sweet shoes, faces like jack-o'-lanterns, in gray slouch hats, slug me, beat me, scream jumps out, like blowtorch, three kicks between the legs that kill the kids, that make tomorrow bars and floors skyrocket and burst like Roman candles. When you throw cold water on me, I'll sign the paper." Just last week, on November 26th, a young music producer, Michael Sekler, a black man, stepped out of his car and walked to his studio. The French police spotted him, and because he didn't have his mask on, they took things into their hands. One would think that the forces of law and order would cautiously ask a citizen to put on his mask, but it seems as if Mr. Zekler had committed an even bigger crime, the crime to be black. The police pursued him into his studio. The three police officers punched, kicked, and beat him up to bits, cracking his skull. To ice the cake, they screamed, "Sale nègre," while mishandling him. As if that was not enough, Mr. Zekler was detained for 48 hours, accused of violence against the police, until video camera recordings were retrieved that proved the contrary. Just a few days before that, on the evening of November 23rd, the police had been sent to clear an illegal camp of Afghan refugees on the Place de la République in Paris. In this process of clearing up, the forces of law and order were out to prove that the public space wasn't an appropriate space to host neither the tents of the refugees nor their bodies. Excessive amount of force was implemented not only in the beating up of the refugees, but also journalists documenting the event. I'll skip a part that names a couple of other violences by the police, but it doesn't matter now. In all of this, it's difficult not to think of the infamous Theo case that happened in 2017, when a young Black youth worker called Theo was beaten up and raped by the French police in Aulnay-sous-Bois. Theo was racially abused, spat on, and beaten around his genital, and eventually sodomized by police with a truncheon. The mass indignation and riots against state brutality led to President François Hollande paying a visit to him after his emergent surgery. That was NTM with the title Police, Act 3. Some have qualified Belarus as the last dictatorship in Europe. Since 1994, that is 26 years, Belarus has been run by the firm and violent grip of Alexander Lukashenko. To sustain himself in power for 5 terms now, he has changed the constitution of his country several times. In an effort to stay in as president for the seat time, Lukashenko locked up all political competitors and monopolized the state media that sang his praises. The election that was done in the absence of local international election observers was rigged, and the Central Election Committee announced that Lukashenko won by 80%. But the Belarusian, knowing he cheated, are not willing to accept these results. People of all ages and classes have been flooding the streets in 50 cities to peacefully protest against the rigging of the elections. Their peaceful protests have been met by extreme police brutality, as peaceful marchers have been beaten up, shot with rubber bullets, terrorized with light and sound grenades, and over 5,000 people have been imprisoned. Lukashenko, flaunting a Kalashnikov, has sworn he will stay in power while ordering his police forces to continue brutalizing citizens that have done nothing else but protest peacefully in the city.
Ты чакаешь родный край, но там ты не обрывай, полюбил
That's a piece by Dashed Darugu with the title Bajuba, a group from Belarus. I think you should watch the video if you have the possibility. It's incredible. It's very beautifully shot, but showing the extreme violence of the police, you know, just mowing citizens. Act four. In the ENSAS Now demonstrations in Nigeria a few weeks ago, a woman in Lagos stood with a megaphone in her right hand and a placard in the left stating, "The power of the people is stronger than the people in power." Hundreds of thousands of young people had taken over the streets of Lagos and other cities in Nigeria, protesting against the incredible violences they receive from the special police unit called SARS, Special Anti-Robbery Squad, and demonstrating for better governance in Nigeria. Many of them camped on the streets, carrying and singing the Nigerian national anthem and waving flags. The protests were in the most part peaceful and progressive until the government of President Buhari set a curfew as a means to contain the protests. On October 20, protesters gathered at the Lekki toll gate, preventing cars from using the major motorway. Early evening, electricity was turned off, monitoring cameras turned off, and the protesters were kettled by men in military fatigues. Then the open fire. Images of falling bodies, blood-soaked flags, screaming and running youths were streamed live online on Instagram and Facebook as the police massacred its own citizens. People they were supposed to protect. Brutality, I call it insanity. That was Police Brutality by Majek Fashek. So I'll end here. There's much more to read and to talk about, but I'll end here since we don't have much time.
Thank you so much, Bonna. And indeed, your talks, I mean, it's almost ridiculous how well they fit together. It's almost a continuation of the first part of your lecture, or what you kind of shared with us now could be the continuation of the Do You Hear the People Sing project. I also realized, but it's on a side note, the connections. You mentioned that the title of Do You Hear the People Sing comes from Les Misérables, the old Victor Hugo piece, and the musical. I think the original is A la Volonté du Peuple, is the name in the original French. The last year, you probably saw the movie that won also the Cannes Prize of the Jury. It was like a readaptation of Les Misérables. All of this is set in Paris, in Montfermeil. You mentioned earlier the riots that started in 2005 when these two teenagers died while fleeing from the police. The original Victor Hugo is set also in Montfermeil in this movie. I don't know if you both have seen this movie. Is set in the contemporary, this contemporary part of the city, and deals exactly with police brutality, or follows like three cops to the banlieues, basically. Mm. So that's an interesting connection that happened now from your title to the topic of your talk that I see here happening. And then I was thinking that the, let's say, protests or the riots as a subject now here, they offer like temporary images of another story of the city, about the city, than the official one. And they also offer somehow temporary and alternative ways of like organizing and governing the city. They offer different truths, like different forms of knowledge. I believe you, and this is now to Bonaventure, one of your claims for Savi is that you have this postulation of another knowledge is possible. And I think that's what you're trying to do with all your work as a curator, also what you did just in your presentation. Maybe against all these thoughts that I put together here, you can elaborate a little bit on this one, Bonaventure.
I think you're totally right. We claim that we find knowledges in other spaces other than the conventional ones. The city should be understood as a more complicated space. There are the multiple truths, as you said, you know, the people. I remember an exhibition that Simon Jami did a couple of years ago called the Xenopolis, you know, which I thought was very interesting as an idea, like the city or the space of foreigners, you know, in which, you know, for my article for that project, I wrote about the different layers in which people exist within the city. There are people, the groups of people that come out only at particular times in the night. The people that come out, you know, that don't go to certain spaces because they will be seen. And the mere fact that they are seen makes them a prey, you know, to the police, to some violences, you know. So I'm interested in these different layers in the city space, just like we're interested at Savi in different layers of knowledges, you know. So the idea to work with the Sonic was to, it's a pity we didn't have enough time because I would have really liked to talk about what these people are singing about. And I had to choose three pieces also geographically to spread it out. But I would really like to talk about, you know, maybe what happened in Minneapolis, you know, that led to the incredible insurrections and indignations last summer. I would have liked to talk about what is happening in Cameroon, you know, over 4 years with extreme brutality. But basically what I was trying to do is just to use the Sonic as a possibility of telling, as a possibility of narration, you know. So as you mentioned before we even started the conversation, I've been collecting, and thank you again, Lucas, for sending me some of the music. So I've been collecting music and sounds in general around police misuse of power, you know, police brutality, you know, and it's incredible that this comes hand in hand with the idea of the nation state itself and the idea of sovereignty itself, you know. So the city, so living the city is, for certain people, a very violent and very dangerous thing to do.
Yes, and that's why I'm so grateful for this combination, because this is one of our also topics within the exhibition that space, city space, is always a political space, and it's not the same for everyone. It's experienced very, very differently. You said it very well in the beginning that the city space, the urban environment, is somewhat like the playground of the Staatsgewalt, of the power structure that is manifested, but in particular in certain bodies, in certain members of the society. So space is not in the urban environment, not the same for everyone and not experienced the same, and is never not political. And I think that's what you're also doing in the work, your work, Michelle, of Crimson, to always kind of remind people of like the political nature of the space that we inhabit and also of the creation of this very space.
True.
That True. Goes in hand with an idea of also responsibility.
Yeah, and that is also because, of course, our background, when I say the professionals that we are dealing with, are often designers. So that's the people who design streets and squares, etc. And they often pretend like this is about the function, it's about quantity, it's about aesthetics. But to stress that this also has a political layer, I think is very important, so that also designers are aware of their sort of political function, if you may. And of course, there's always an ambiguity to that. So if you strive for a more equal or fair, inclusive city, all the buzzwords of these of this decade, then it is ambiguous, of course, that you have to consider that public space is not only for the certain groups that are mistreated now and that that want more democracy, but it's also for groups that are maybe protesting for causes that you don't applaud, or that, like the one that you just mentioned, it's also for the anti-virus or vaccine people, etc. They are also part of our city. And these kind of ambiguities I'm interested in, though I am not so sure how I want to deal with that.
So just to add to that, Lucas and Michelle, so that violence exists on so many levels, right? So one would be the physical presence of bodies and so on and so forth, you know, or the vulnerability of certain bodies within certain city spaces, but also on the other level, you know, like with history, with the way we navigate space, so street names, and the history of particular spaces within cities, you know. So if I take the example, and that is also the psychological violence that is enacted on people. So what does it mean to constantly pass by a street that is called the Mohrenstrasse? You understand? So that kind of violence in the naming as well. Or we're sitting here at Savvy across a plaza called skip my mind right now, but the thing is, this guy this space is named after a guy who was very much involved in the slave enterprise, but there's no contextualization of that. You understand? Mm-hmm. So yeah. You're constantly confronted with this reality, and that is also violent, you know.
Yeah, there's always of course, this is a huge discussion. This may be a completely new discussion, but in Berlin, I think the city is quite experienced with this question of what history do you want to keep? What history do you want to preserve? Is the GDR history also worth preserving, or is that also a kind of violence that was put on people? So that is, that's maybe slightly different discussion, but I think especially for public space, I completely agree with you that history, public space should be something that accommodates everybody and not create some kind of psychological violence through names or through statues that people are actually not aware of. And I think that happens a lot. Speaking for myself, this is also something that certain groups, older white groups, were not aware of at all before the last decade. So, and I think that's also what protests have brought us, that we think about the city and who has access and who feels at home, for whom is the city actually made? And how can you feel everybody feel like an equal person, like they are welcome? And that has to do with maybe small things like names, but absolutely with things like that. So yeah, I tend to agree with you on that, yes.
And Bonner, if you want another closing remark, otherwise I would start to wrap our conversation up here, even though this could obviously go on forever and ever.
Well, what can I say? The closing remark would be that, I mean, I would like to develop this a bit further and think about the different sublayers of the city space, and think about, you know, how can we consider music as history writing? And so the stories of the violences of the police or the state apparatus is reflected in the sonic, in music, in pop culture. So that is what I would like to explore. So actually, the public space is reflected in the sonicity of the contemporary. So, and looking at this, I think in listening to music from different places about police brutality, we'll be able to make a map of this, you know, the things that they have in common, which is actually power, exercising power massively on certain bodies.
Yeah, power and powerlessness. And what's nice, looking at both of your presentations, your form of research, whether it's kind of through these kind of allegorical visual drawings, or whether it's through kind of these sonic explorations, but you both represent a very creative form of, like, highly political, but a very eclectic form of research that finds its output in very different mediums and takes also popular culture very serious as material to investigate. It's not popular culture that's not look at this music, no, because it's a direct reflect, everything is a direct reflection of the global realities that we're living in.
So sorry for interrupting, plaza, I forgot, is Nettelbeckplatz. So check out the guy Nettelbeck. It's just in my front door, but for some reason I forgot it, you know, interesting fellow.
This brings me to the other point. So thank you for kind of sharing this form of research that you're doing that is highly topical and highly like active in looking at the world that we're living in and questioning it. And what we're trying to do with the exhibition Living the City is also questioning, let's say, dominant narratives of the European city. What is actually European city? How do we look at it, or city in general? But never mind the European, but the very intentional attempt in our case of, in a playful way, create critical spaces. And again, question like dominant narratives and offer a multiplicity of stories within the city.
And Lucas, the city, in the history of the city, as you know better than I do, is also embedded the history of exclusion.
Correct.
Exclusion of certain people who has the possibility of being in the city. You understand? And also, so in that, so the partitioning of the city says a lot about the social fabric of the city itself and the city dwellers, you know. So that's why I find your project extremely important. You know, how do we understand the city that way? Who has the possibility of living where? You know, so we know that certain people get certain illnesses because they can only afford to live in certain parts of cities where they are contaminated. Therefore, they get or exposed to certain noises. They can live close to airports and so on and so forth, you know. So I think these play a very important role. And the city in itself, studying the city, of course, that has been done in many cases, but it's becoming more and more important in my opinion, the understanding of the social fabric.
Exactly. And it's always a political object. And kind of wrapping it up, so that in any case, the very concepts of like public space or democracy and citizenship are like ultimately defined or redefined also through lived experience by the people. And maybe that takes radical urbanism. So let's leave this as a question mark for tonight's talk. I would like to thank both of you once again on behalf of the entire curatorial team of Living the City for being with us again. These talks could go on and go on and go on. We have limited time. Thank you to the two of you. And this is our second to last double feature. Next one on Thursday again, 7 o'clock. Thank you so much also to the audience for being with us, and I hope to see you soon.